Okay, so the next speaker is Pratim Roy, and he's going to talk about his work on exploring complexity and entanglement in holographic systems. Pratim, please take over.
Am I audible?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, please go ahead. Yes.
Yes, so thank you for the introduction. So I'll be talking about exploring complexity and entanglement in holographic systems. Specifically, the topic I shall be most concentrating on is the relationship, if any, between these two seemingly disparate quantities in holographic systems. I shall point out similarities and differences in the behavior of these two quantities as and when appropriate. So this is largely based on this paper in JHEP, but I shall also include some material from an old paper which came out in 2017 for completeness. I think that will round out the presentation nicely. So I shall also acknowledge my collaborators. I have had the fortune to work with numerous collaborators at different stages. So they are given in the slide. Yeah, so this is the outline of my talk. This is a very rough outline. I shall deviate from this as and when necessary, but primarily I shall talk about ADS CFT and information theoretic quantities in strongly coupled field theories. I shall first talk about the Ryu Takayanagi and the ADS-CFT dictionary, which is the canonical example for information theoretic quantities in ADS-CFT. Some preliminary results from complexity equal to volume conjecture will be gone over. Then I shall mostly talk about results from the complexity equals action conjecture. They shall include the complexity and entanglement calculation in simple systems, and I shall also introduce the notion of an entanglement wedge, which I don't think any of the previous speakers have spoken about in any detail. Then I shall present the chief results about subregion complexity in BTZ and ADS3. These are the aforementioned simple systems I was talking about. And I shall end with summary and conclusions. I should also mention that out of necessity, I shall probably repeat some of the information alluded to by the previous speakers. So I'm just including that for completeness. I shall go over that as quickly as I can. Yeah, so complexity, this is how it's defined, as Shira and Pratik alluded to. Complexity of a quantum state is defined as the minimal possible number of elementary unitary transformations required to build that given state from a reference state of our choosing. Now, some qualification about the word elementary is justified. Elementary in this case means simple unitary transformations which are made of the kinematic variables of the system under consideration. So we have this state psi t, and to reach this state psi t from a given reference state psi r, we have to operate a series of unitary transformations given by u 1 up to un on the reference state psi r. And the complexity is obtained by the minimal number of possible transformations necessary to produce the target state from the reference state. I should mention that this quantity is well studied in the literature of information theory, but holographic and field theoretic studies are more recent. In fact, I should also mention that in this particular case, somewhat peculiarly, field theoretic studies, to the best of my knowledge, came after the holographic studies. Usually in ADS-CFT, often it's the other way around. In this case, it's the other way around. So the motivation for the introduction of this quantity in the ADS-CFT literature is as follows. So Maldacena and collaborators studied entanglement entropy for an internal two-sided black hole to probe physics behind the horizon. This was back in 2013. They found that the Einstein-Rosen bridge, which connects the two boundaries, keeps growing classically with time. In contrast, however, the entanglement entropy grows linearly with time and then saturates at a time which is dependent on the system or the subsystem size. This is called thermalization. And this result is actually well known from I guess any number of sources, including conformal field theory and calculation of entanglement entropy in spin chains. Not spin chains, I mean harmonic chains. Yeah. So motivated by these results, they were led to ask these questions that, for example, we have the ADS-CFT dictionary, which has been long known. So in the ADS-CFT dictionary, for example, the length of geodesics corresponds to correlators on the CFT side. The area of the minimal surface corresponds to entanglement entropy. Now, what should the size of the Einstein-Rosen bridge correspond to? Now, size, I am necessarily keeping as a rough notion for now. I am not specifying it. So it was Susskind and collaborators first put forward the notion that the size of the Einstein-Rosen bridge may be given by the complexity, and subsequently it was also proposed that the reduced density matrix, in other words, the density matrix produced by tracing out some subsystem from the total composite system, corresponds to a quantity called the entanglement wedge in the bulk theory. In this entanglement wedge, I don't think the previous speakers have spoken about. So I shall briefly go over the construction and the definition of the entanglement wedge later. Now, this is not a slide to be taken very seriously. Basically, if you will recall, the central notion of my talk is the relationship between entanglement and complexity. Now, so far, these appear to be two separate quantities. Now, is there any reason to suppose that they are related or unrelated? If they are related, what is the relationship between them? Can it be found at all? So, as to the question of whether they are related or unrelated, a naive argument based on two coupled oscillators goes like this. For example, we have the states Psi R and Psi T. Psi R we choose to be an unentangled Gaussian, which is parametrized by some reference frequency omega R. And Psi T is given in this given in the expression on the screen. Here you will note that Psi T is no longer unentangled. There is some entanglement between the two oscillators whose positions are given by x1 and x2. That's given by this cross term. So to build quote unquote Psi T out of Psi R, a schematic circuit of the following form would need to be implemented. So in between. Amongst the n unitary operators which operate on Psi R, we would also need to include an entangling operator, which is, this is a small typo here, which is of this form, where epsilon is a small infinitesimal parameter. Now, to build this entanglement, we all obviously need to insert this operator, which will, of course, affect the length of the circuit, which is what we have to optimize to find the complexity. Now, as I mentioned before, there is a huge caveat here. This is an extremely simplified picture, perhaps too simple. This is there could be any number of cases where this simple picture does not hold. Nevertheless, I find it instructive to keep this in mind while picturing the relationship between entanglement and complexity. Yeah. So there are, as the previous speakers mentioned, there are two proposals currently in the literature, two chief proposals, I should say, for computing complexity using holographic methods. The first of these is the complexity equals volume proposal. This is due to Susskind and collaborators put forward in 2016, which states that the complexity is proportional to the volume of the maximal volume size anchored at TL and TR. Here TL and TR simply refer to the two time coordinates on the two boundaries of the eternal two-sided black hole. And the complexity formula is given by the formula marked in red. Now here I should mention that this arbitrary factor L scale must appear in the definition to make the dimensions consistent. But this actually is usually taken to be the length scale of ADS, but in principle it could be anything. So this is one of the problems, I should say, in the definition, or not a problem, arbitrariness a source of arbitrariness in the definition of complexity equals volume. And this was what eventually led to the complexity equals area conjecture. Now, the complexity equals, it should be evident that complexity behaves roughly the same way as volume. So basically volume, the rate of change of the volume is linearly proportional to the time, which is that behavior observed in the two-sided black hole by Maldason and collaborators. And another interesting property is that at high temperatures, it should be proportional to, the rate of change should be proportional to the temperature times entropy for a black hole. This actually leads to a bound in the literature, which is known as the Lloyd bound. That's an interesting proposal, but I shall not talk about it further in this talk.
May I ask some simple questions here?
Sure. Please go ahead.
So in the second slide where you have shown two harmonic oscillator states and you are going from one state to another state. Yes. Yeah. So, and you already defined that complexity is the minimum number of operators that you need to operate here. So in this case, complexity must be a number, just a number.
Complexity is, it's a number.
In this case, what would be the number like what I can
see? That you would have to calculate. Basically, you need hello?
Depends on the type of unitary operators that I use, right?
Yeah, the type of unitary operators that you choose.
Okay. And second simplest question is, when you talked about this complexity is equivalent to the volume, in such cases, how do we think about what are the states that we are taking when you are talking about these wormholes and everything?
Well, typically you talk about the thermofield double state. I shall actually, the specific states I am considering, I shall talk about later.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Okay. I hope I answer your question subsequently. If not, please.
Yes. Thank you.
Okay. So, so far at least, we have considered complexity equals volume for, we have not considered it for subregions, and the proposal was not originally made for subregions, but the proposal can be modified to consider subregions, and this was done by Ali Shahia in 2015. Of course, when we talk about subregions, we talk about mixed states. So the complexity equals volume proposal for subregions is given by the formula given on your screen, where V gamma A is the volume considered and contained under the Ryu-Takayanagi minimal surface. The Ryu-Takayanagi minimal surface, I guess, is familiar to most of the audience. So basically, this is a surface which is anchored, whose boundary is coincident with the boundary of the conformal field theory, which exists on the boundary of ADS, and the bulk surface extends into ADS as a whole. Now the Ryu-Takayanagi surface divides the ADS boundary into two complementary regions. So this is the source for the name. So the advantage of this proposal is that it is intuitively and computationally close to the Ryu-Takayanagi computations, which are the most well-known examples of the geometric calculations of information theoretic quantities in ADS CFT. I should also mention that like entanglement entropy, complexity in this formulation, and also in the complexity equals action formulation, as a matter of fact, is a formally a divergent quantity due to the large number of degrees of freedom. And you can actually tell how this infinity is coming to the picture very naturally. That's because the volume for which volume under consideration, that surface extends to the ADS boundary from where the infinity is coming to the picture. So we shall talk about some very simple systems. So first of all, as I alluded to earlier, there are two parts to the complexity. One is the finite part, and another is the divergent part. So the divergent structure we shall first look at. So for that, let's consider a general ADS D plus one metric. So this is, familiar to most of you. And for this, we shall consider the following entangling region. This is a strip of length small l and width l. So basically, this is encoded in the boundary directions in the metric, and the lapse functions under temperature of this are given as you see. Now the area functional is familiar from the literature. There is nothing new about it. The area functional is given by this expression, and the minimal surface you can find out by simple methods, Hamiltonian optimization, and you can find out the minimal surface formula like this. And I should mention here that R star is the turning point of the surface. In any Ryu-Takanagi surface, it's characterized by the turning point. Yeah. So subregion volume is given by the formula in red. The only modification to the entanglement entropy formula is that now we have to consider two integrals instead of just one, and of course that introduces additional mathematical complications. So basically, this XR is the formula for the Ryu-Takayanagi surface, which is given by this. This already involves an integral, and it is impossible to for any Reisner-Nordström configuration. It is impossible to compute this formula analytically in a closed form without any approximation. So we make the following solution. Now we substitute RH by R star, where RH is the horizon radius and R star is the turning point. We treat it as an expansion parameter, expand F and integrate. Now basically, since RH is involved here, and RH is, as you will note, involved in the formula for temperature, this is basically reducing to an expansion in temperature, as you can see from the formula. So I have these actually T1, T2, T3, etc. These are reasonably ugly quantities, and I shall not write them out in full detail. But this is basically what the formula looks like. Now, T1, T2, T3 are given by these complicated gamma functions. But here, the only things that I would like for you to note is the divergence factors delta, which are given in blue. And we cannot do this for general D analytically, even with this approximation. So we check it for various dimensionalities of various values of D. So for example, for D equal to 3, this is for ATS4 then. The volume is given by this formula schematically, where A1, A2, A3, these are all finite. Now, basically, you will note that the divergence structure is similar to, entanglement entropy, but there is a log divergence that is appearing. But this is actually spurious and deceptive. This is basically this is an artifact of the near horizon expansion. And the way to determine that is that one can compute the entanglement entropy complexity for a normal Schwarzschild black hole without chemical potential. One can compute them exactly and with this near horizon expansion. And you can clearly tell from that this log divergence appears there also. And it's an artifact of this near horizon expansion. It's not a true divergence. Okay. By the way, yeah, was there a question?
Dipto here.
Yeah, please go on.
So this is a black brain, right?
Yeah.
Charged black brain. So this Ryu-Takanagi surface, does it extend to the horizon? Because you're talking about near horizon divergence.
Near horizon, but it doesn't penetrate the horizon.
Okay, so I extend the surface up to the horizon and construct the causal volume and calculate that. Is that what it's doing?
Construct the Ryu-Takanagi volume. Yeah, well, I guess you can call it the causal volume, since Ryu-Takanagi is consistent with causality.
Okay. Thank you.
Anything further?
No, thanks.
Okay. There is a slight abuse of notation which is occurring here. I am referring to the volume and the complexity interchangeably, but since volume is exactly proportional, complexity is exactly proportional to the volume, This is understandable. This is perfectly fine. Yeah, so this is the, I shall spare you the details. So this is a table of results for the low temperature and high temperature limits. So basically one can find that the finite parts of the complexity, the finite parts of the complexity behave exactly the same way as entanglement entropy. The expressions for the corresponding expressions for entanglement entropy exist in the literature, and we compared them in this paper, and we found that the finite parts behave exactly in the same way as entanglement entropy. In other words, they are dependent on the ADS volume and the dimensions of the subsystem, and the divergences differ by a factor of 1 by delta, which is also fine. Now, given these similarities, one may reasonably ask if complexity indicates anything new in any physical situation compared with entanglement entropy. Now, the only way to answer that question is to carry out these computations in different physical circumstances and check whether it tells us anything, whether complexity tells us anything new. Now, for this, we shall take an equally simple system. This is a Reisner-Nordström black hole in 4 dimensions with spherical topology. I mean, the horizon is spherical, and the line element, lapse function and temperature are given by this. Now, this is, of course, nothing new. The thermodynamics of the system has been extensively studied in both fixed charge, fixed potential ensembles in numerous publications. And it's well known that the system undergoes a phase transition at a critical charge, which is given by QC equals 1/6 for a particular choice of parameters. We study the behavior of holographic complexity in the neighborhood of this phase transition. And I should also say that we look at this phase transition as a purely geometric phenomenon, and we ask whether complexity can tell us anything new about it. Now, in one short word, no, it can't. So this is the basically this is plotting the renormalized complexity for different configurations. Beta is the inverse temperature, and the reason to regularize this is basically just that to extract the finite part, and true to form, the finite part of the complexity gives us exactly the same information. I repeat, exactly the same information as does entanglement entropy. Now, I should mention here one surprising thing, that in this particular, for this particular choice of parameters, we are far from the thermal regime of large subsystem size. We should expect to be far from that regime, and yet we have reproduced exactly the same features as entanglement entropy and black hole entropy when plotting complexity. There are other regions of the phase space of the black hole where we have carried out similar investigations, and invariably it shows that exactly the same information is conveyed by entanglement entropy and complexity. Yeah, so I should ask for the complexity equals volume section, are there any questions? Okay, if not, I shall go ahead to the complexity equals action conjecture. Yeah, so due to the problems with the arbitrary length scale in the complexity equals volume conjecture, it was further refined by numerous authors like Brown, Roberts, Susskind and others in 2016, and they introduced the following prescription. We take the same eternal two-sided black hole we are familiar with, and we compute the action of the Wheeler-David patch of the theory. Now, the Wheeler-David patch is actually a region bounded by light sheets emanating from two specific points anchored on the boundary of the two-sided black hole. So basically, we take two arbitrary points on either side of the black hole, on either side of the black hole. We construct null light sheets from each point, and they delineate this Wheeler-David patch. And by the way, this is a new type of structure in the bulk, and basically the action computation is not that straightforward, as we shall see. So basically we need to compute the action of the theory on this Wheeler-David patch, which is given by this large equation. The first two terms should be familiar to most people. They are the bulk term and the Gibbons-Hawking boundary term. The remaining terms may be unfamiliar to some people, and basically this is due to the fact that we are not considering any ordinary region of the bulk. We are considering especially a region which includes null joints. Basically, null joint is a point where the two null surfaces meet. Along with the null surfaces, the specific forms of these two of these terms are given in the literature, and they were first put out by these authors in 2016. I should mention that some of the terms were known previously, but this paper is the first one I know of that where this action was written out in complete generality. Yeah. So one of the new terms is the Hayward joint term that arises at the intersection of two boundary segments. And there is also a term due to the null boundary. So this is basically this null boundary term, but this we can set actually to zero by appropriate parameterization of the null boundaries, which leads to its own set of problems, which I shall describe later. Yeah, so the last term that is of interest is the joint term resulting from the intersection of two surfaces, at least one of which is null. Now this term A is given by the considering the dot products of the normals, outward pointing normals from the null joints, whether they be space-like null joint or time-like null joint, and to ensure reparametrization invariance due to the ambiguity in parametrization of the joint terms, the following counter term is also needed, whose form is given in the literature. Yeah. So the last thing we shall need to describe the results further is the notion of an entanglement wedge. Now, the entanglement wedge for Poincaré and global ADS was considered in by Rongomoni and co-authors in 2013. Basically, they look something like this. We consider the subregion A in the boundary, and we consider a domain of dependence A of A, which is given by this sort of diamond shape on the boundary, which we call a causal diamond, and its bulk domains of influence extend deep, but their intersection does not. Basically, this is this region which is bounded by these light sheets, and this blue curve is what we shall be interested in calculating explicitly. Now, yeah, so the reason I introduced the notion of an entanglement wedge is because the subregion generalization to the complexity equals action proposal is briefly this. So according to the complexity equals action proposition, the subregion complexity of the dual of a dual mixed state on the boundary, by mixed state I mean some part of the boundary has been traced out, is proportional to the gravitational action evaluated on the bulk region given by the intersection of the Wheeler-DeWitt patch and the entanglement wedge of the given subregion under consideration. So this was put forward by Myers and co-authors in 2017, and the pictorial representation of the situation is given by this figure. Now the part in yellow is the entanglement wedge, and the part in that is delineated in red is the Wheeler-DeWitt patch. As you can see, we consider some subsystem A, and from this point we emanate light sheets and also construct the domain of dependence and the entanglement wedge. Now we shall be interested in calculating the gravitational action in the intersection of the Wheeler-DeWitt patch and the entanglement wedge. I don't know if you can make it out adequately from this figure, but basically we shall be interested in the region which is extends into the boundary and is delineated by these blue curves. First of all, there are most calculations in ADS CFT, we have to consider the problem of regularization, since this Wheeler-DeWitt patch extends to the boundary of the spacetime. So basically these are two possible regularizations that can be done. They are both considered in the literature, we shall primarily use the first regularization, although we have worked out the entirety of the results for the second regularization and they match entirely. So the system we shall consider is a BTZ black hole, and whose metric is in three dimensions is given by this. The lapse function has a particularly simple form, and we consider a boundary subsystem of dimension L. Since we are considering a three-dimensional metric, for surfaces, this is just another way of saying geodesics. Now the equation for the space-like geodesic at t equals zero, so this is the Ryu Takayanagi surface, is given by this form, where the parameter j is sort of like an angular momentum and is given by this. And basically, this serves as one of the primary motivations for choosing BTZ, as in geodesics are exactly analytically solvable here in this case. Now, obviously, we need the geodesics and the null geodesics specifically to explicitly consider the forms of the Wheeler of the I'm sorry the entanglement wedge. Now, you can do it for any number of dimensions, maybe numerically, and we have done so. But for BTZ, the situation is actually simple. And the motivation is this, because we shall, for computing the complexity, we shall basically need the analytical expression for the intersection between the Wheeler-David patch and the entanglement wedge. And basically that locus is given by this blue curve. Yeah, so in this case, the equation for the entanglement wedge is actually simple. It's given by this this equation, where the term alpha has, where the term constant alpha has not a particularly pretty form, but nevertheless can be analytically computed, which is not the case for maybe say Schwarzschild ADS 4 or 5. Or indeed most other systems. So basically this the cross section of this two dimensional cross section of this situation is given by this figure below, and one can see that basically these two situations are equivalent. Now we shall also need the equations for the Wheeler-David patch, and which are light sheets, so we shall need to construct the radial null geodesics, which are given by this expression, where epsa is the basically the regularization parameter. We consider that the Wheeler-David patch stops at an infinitesimal distance epsa from the space-time boundary. And the check for this expression is that we can consider the Z going to infinite limit. So basically that is the limit of flat ADS 3. And there we may physically reasonably expect that the Wheeler-David patch is just a null cone, which actually it is. So that serves as a check of the previous expression. The last thing we shall need is, last couple of things we shall need is the locus of the intersection between the Wheeler-David patch and the entanglement wedge, which is straightforwardly found out like this. These expressions are analytically obtainable, and also the maximum value of the transversal coordinate, which is the coordinate zx, which is the boundary coordinate, is given by this expression, which also unfortunately involves epsa. Now the Wheeler-David patch, we break up this integral of the action into several pieces. We first integrate along 0 to t w dw, and then we consider the radial integration. You could flip the order of integration, and in principle the answer remains unchanged. It is possible to check this explicitly for maybe empty Schwarzschild, empty ADS, but for the black hole the situation is not that trivial. But in principle, physically, they should give the flipping the order of integration should give the same result. The reason I am mentioning this is that for complicated integrals like this, which integral to do first is a non-trivial question. It can simplify or complicate your calculations accordingly. So the bulk integral is given by these two terms, and as I said, we first integrate the time along 0 to t dwdw, and then from 0 to t 0 to t ew. Tew denotes the equation for the entanglement wedge, and these hash symbols are basically involve ugly looking expressions, which is why I am not giving them here. And the result can be also be exactly computed, but it is a complicated function of Poy logs, and the result is not illuminating to look at, which is why it's not presented here. Now we shall also have to consider joint terms. So there are three joints here. The joint for which the Willard-David patch meets the regulator surface, the joint where the entanglement wedge meets the Ryutaka-Kanagi surface, and the joint where the Willard-David patch meets the entanglement wedge. If you look at this picture, if you keep it in mind, these three terms, the reason for them should be self-evident. Now, the specific form of the joint contribution is given in the literature, where sigma is the induced metric determinant on the codimension 2 surface. And as I said, the expression depends largely on the expression for the null normals. For the given null normals whose forms are k plus and k minus, they are easy to calculate. We can also compute the tangents to the null geodesics. Basically, the chief method for constructing this entanglement wedge is that we trace out at each point the tangent to the surface. The tangents to the null geodesics are given by this expression, where E and J are the constants parameterizing the geodesics, and we shall also need to ensure that the null geodesics that delimit the entanglement wedge are normal to the Ryutaka-Kanagi surface. That is, they emerge from the Ryutaka-Kanagi surface perpendicularly. So these are the boundary conditions. The dot product of V mu, the null tangents to the null geodesics, and the derivative of the expression for the Ryutaka-Kanagi surface and the boundary conditions ensure that this condition is met. The condition being that the null geodesics should be emanating perpendicularly to the Ryutaka-Kanagi surface. Basically, the second expression ensures that the null geodesics end up on the Ryutaka-Kanagi surface, where the normals to the entanglement which can be straightforwardly constructed, which is necessary if you look back on the formula for the action. The reason I am showing you these expressions is that to impress upon you that even though they are not nice to look at, we shall have some simplifications in short order. Now, the total joint contribution is given by these expressions, which are, as you see them, the total joint contribution is given by the expression at the bottom of your screen. This expression is horrendous to look at, but nevertheless, when we put all these things together, by all these things, I mean the joint contribution, the surface contribution, and the integration for the bulk term, we end up with a remarkably simplified expression, which is given by CA BTZ. And the, for yielding this simplification, we basically have to consider some identities about polylogarithms. Nevertheless, the final expression, even coming from these ugly expressions, is simple. And that's given by this. C is, of course, the central charge of the dual conformal field theory. And L tilde is L by alpha. And we already know the expression for the entanglement entropy of an interval for this particular setup. And we may rewrite the CA BTZ in this form. And this looks particularly instructive because this relates complexity to the entanglement entropy. So basically, in addition to the linearly divergent term and the term that is proportional to the entanglement entropy, we have a constant piece which is proportional to the central charge of the conformal field theory. Yeah, And one of the checks for this expression is we consider L by ZH much greater than one limit, which is actually the limit for empty ADS. We consider, we end up with the following expression for the complexity, where one of the log divergences has been suppressed, and we end up with this expression, which is actually a result obtained by Hedrick and Dagon in 2018 through other methods. I should maybe say a word about this other method. It's not an our method as such. Basically, if you consider this simple limit, the entanglement wedge becomes very simple to construct. And so the expression for the subregion complex in that limit is accordingly as simple. So there is a problem even in this simple, so-called simple answer. That's this free scale L tilde, which causes some ambiguity. But we shall make use of this L tilde later. So for now, I'm not saying any more about it. Now, this represents a reasonably compact relationship between the complexity and the entanglement entropy. The pertinent thing to ask would be whether a similar relationship holds true for maybe say ADS3. This is an even simpler example, and we can go through the exact same exercise for ADS3 and end up with this expression. And you may see that it exhibits the same characteristics of BTZ, as in a divergence proportional to the length of the subregion on the boundary, a subleading divergence proportional to the entanglement entropy, and a constant finite piece, which is proportional to the central charge of the theory. Someone might ask, this geometry can be obtained as a limit of BTZ. So is this result something new? And does this really tell us about the general structure, general relationship between entanglement entropy and complexity? And the answer is, for more complicated geometries and for more complicated setups, this behavior is unfortunately not preserved. So the more complicated setup is this. We consider two disjoint intervals in ADS3. We initially wanted to consider disjoint intervals in BTZ, but they proved too difficult to analytically handle. And the setup is just this. We consider two segments of size L with a separation equal to D, located on the space-time boundary on the constant time slice T equals 0. Now, if any of you have done computations on mutual information in the context of entanglement entropy, this is a familiar setup. This is a symmetric configuration in which the two boundary subregions are given by these two ranges of X. And basically, we consider two symmetric subsystems separated by a distance D. I beg your pardon. And it is well known in the literature that for specific values of L and the end of the separation D, there are two possible extremal surfaces anchored at the boundary at the edges of the two subregions. That's the situation which is given pictorially by these two figures. They should be familiar to anybody who is familiar with mutual information calculation in holography. Yeah. So this, as I mentioned, is a fact that has long been known since back in 2004 from Rongomoni and Coathas. So there are two cases to be considered. The first case is that the extremal surface, which for the BTZ for ADS3 is just a geodesic, is given by the union of the Ryu-Takayanagi surfaces for the individual subregions. So this is the minimal surface for a separation D, which exceeds the critical value, which is given by this root over 2 minus 1 multiplied by L. This D0 is the critical distance beyond which there is a phase transition to a separate scenario, which is the case given by number 2. And here it's the right hand figure actually describes the situation perfectly. There is a single extremal surface connecting two subregions. One can check that this configuration is actually minimal for D less than D0. Now, for this setup consisting of disjoint intervals, the complexity for case one is just given by this simple formula, but which is the total complexity is given by twice the complexity for each segment. And basically this, this formula is not going to reveal any additional structure. The second case is more interesting and complicated. And if you construct the entanglement wedge for this setup, what we end up with is this figure. Now, as you can see, this is qualitatively similar to the setup I showed you earlier, in which there was a simple picture of an entanglement wedge intersecting with a Willard-Debye patch. Here, the situation is substantially more complicated. If you will note the right-hand side of the figure, we have to consider a total of 14 different subregions just for computing the bulk integral. But this is, since this is a symmetric scenario, we can just consider 7 regions and multiply by 2. The different color coding is, I apologize, it's not very clear from this 2D picture, but these color codings actually represent the different quantities and the physical quantities involved. Now, the bulk region is given by the Ryu Takanagi surfaces, which are given by ZRT1 and ZRT2, which are given by these two simple formula. One can see this from these legends. And the null boundaries of the entanglement wedge can be built by sending null geodesics from RT1 and RT2. So basically, these null geodesics emanate from RT1 and RT2 and end up at the boundary of the spacetime. So their equations are given by TEW1 and TEW2. Their forms are also not particularly complicated. And all throughout the calculation, we are for finding out these equations, we are of course keeping in mind the requirements that the null geodesics emanate perpendicularly from the Ryu Takayanagi surface and they terminate at the Ryu Takayanagi surface. So there are two sets of boundary conditions for each entanglement wedge to be enforced here. And the Willard-Debye patch is bounded by this simple equation. This is simply the equation for the Willard-Debye patch, Z minus epsilon. Now, the intersection curve, which is the blue line, is also given by these two equations, TE and ZE. These trace out the locus of the intersection between the Willard-Debye patch and the entanglement wedge. And similarly for the second surface. Now, we also need to consider the intersection between the Willard-Debye patch and the null surface, which is anchored at the second Ryu Takayanagi surface, which is given by these simple expressions. Keep in mind that all of these expressions unfortunately also involve the regularization. At this point, it is pertinent to mention that the details of the regularization procedure, as in the two setups I showed you diagrammatically earlier, on the surface of it, they follow two very different modes of calculation. Nevertheless, they end up at the same result. This is considered in the appendix of the paper I alluded to earlier, so we shall mostly follow one regularization here. And it may be observed that the integrals, involving the evaluation of complexity, they comprise 7 integrals and they are cumbersome in the extreme, so I'm not showing them. The final result evaluates to this expression, this C2A. And one should mention that a divergent part of the above equation has the same characteristics as the single interval for BTZ. But the finite part can no longer be written in such a simple manner so as to express it in terms entanglement entropy. So that elegant structure is lost, I regret to say. At this point, I should mention that one of the two systems considered so far, as in Reisner-Nordström black holes and the BTZ black hole, they have been considered in two different prescriptions, the CV prescription for the first and the CA prescription for the second. There is one unifying theme here, that the divergence structure actually is not that sensitive to which scheme and system we are following. It is basically exactly the same story repeated time and time again, which is that the divergence structure remains consistent and it's off by a factor of 1 by delta from the structure for entanglement entropy. So if you will recall, there is this factor L tilde which was causing some problems, but we shall make use of it now by doing the following. We shall consider mutual complexity, just like mutual information is considered for entanglement entropy, and the mutual complexity is defined by this expression where rho A and rho B are the reduced density matrices in the Hilbert spaces localized in A and B for two disjoint intervals. Skipping over the details, the mutual complexity is given by delta CA. And in this case, of course, as I mentioned, there is no easy way to write down the mutual complexity in terms of entanglement entropy. But it is instructive to plot this delta CA graphically. And denoting by eta the ratio between L tilde and L, we find the following feature. Now, if eta is less than or equal to half, CA is subadditive for all values of delta D by L. Just to remind you, L is the subsystem length for the two symmetric pieces considered. Each of them has a length L, and D is the separation between them. Now, for eta greater than half, it is always possible to find small enough distances giving a superadditive behavior. And moreover, there is a critical eta zero, which is roughly given by this numeric value, in such a way that the complexity of two disjoint intervals is always superadditive if eta is greater than this critical value eta zero. So just to summarize, in order to have a positive definite subregion complexity, of course, subregion complexity, since complexity is basically a number, subregion complexity should always be positive definite. So to ensure a positive definite subregion complexity, we require eta greater than 1. So the upshot of this is that it seems that it is not possible to achieve a universally subadditive complexity in a physically consistent setting. So this is actually consistent with the results obtained by Myers and collaborators with after this archive preprint was put up. And the second remark is that there is a slightly different situation prevailing in the complexity equals volume conjecture, which is superadditive by design, or not by design, I should say by construction. The last thing to be mentioned is that a similar behavior of the subregion complexity was found in the thermofield double state. The subsystems are taken as the two disconnected boundaries of space-time. This was actually investigated by Agon and collaborators in 2014, and they showed that the complexity cause action is subadditive when eta is greater than eta hat d and superadditive for eta greater than eta hat d. So this is basically the same situation we have in this system, but they considered a different system. So this is one basic check of, not a check, this is a confirmation of this result that other groups have found similar results for different systems. The last thing we consider is strong superadditivity. So given two generically overlapping systems A and B, entanglement entropy satisfies the strong subadditivity property, which is given by this equation. So inspired by this relation, from Caceres's paper in 2019, we can define by analogy a generalization of the mutual complexity given by the expression given on your screen. And it can be checked that the CA is strongly subadditive for L by L tilde by L less than half, and strongly superadditive for L by L tilde by L greater than half. So not only is CA superadditive in a physically consistent region of parameter space, it is actually strongly superadditive. Yeah, so I shall summarize briefly what I have said up till now. So we have investigated the relationship between complexity and entanglement in numerous physical systems, and the relationship may not always be obvious, as evidenced by the fact that for some systems we can write down a simple transparent relationship between entanglement, entropy and complexity, and for others the situation is not that simple. And there are some similarities and differences in their behavior, as in we found that for thermodynamics, for black hole thermodynamics, the finite part of the complexity and entanglement entropy present the same information. They do not differ even slightly. For the CV conjecture, the calculation was carried out, and for the CA conjecture, we showed the link between complexity and entanglement entropy in a compact form, which retained the same structure when calculated to empty ADS3. But the caveat is that when a more complicated setup consisting of two disjoint intervals in ADS3 was considered, that this structure collapsed. The same elegant equation didn't hold any further, and we do not know why there should be two different behaviors for this case. So there are some differences also in the additivity properties of complexity and entanglement entropy, namely that entanglement entropy mutual information is subadditive, and complexity is strongly superadditive. Yeah, so I shall next outline some future directions and ongoing work. It is clear that what is the concrete relationship, it is far from clear what is the concrete relationship between complexity and entanglement, especially in mixed states such as we have considered here. Also complicating the situation is that there are other measures of complexity of entanglement in mixed states, such as logarithmic negativity and entanglement of purification. So can any relationship be found between these quantities like these and complexity? This also is far from clear. Even if a relationship exists, it doesn't follow that one can find it easily. Yeah, the other point is what are the thermal contributions to complexity? This can maybe be taken up by computation, by doing computations at finite temperature in harmonic chains. I should add that there is some motivation to doing these computations. There is some evidence in the literature that long distance correlations play a large role in finite temperature transitions in entanglement negativity. This was investigated by Grover and his co-author in 2019, and it would be interesting to note whether a similar relation, similar effect holds true for complexity. And for this, computations in long-range field theories of entanglement negativity and entanglement of purification should be carried out. Other than complexity, some work on this is ongoing, and these two and other similar measures deserve a study for long-range field theories, which is interesting in its own right. Now, I should say that the stumbling block for this kind of studies is that such studies usually involve numerics, and analytic results are far and few in between. So it is not clear whether a numeric study would transparently give one the relationship between entanglement and complexity, which would be much easier if we had analytic expressions. Yeah, so this is the end of my talk. So thank you.
So thanks very much, Pratim, for a very nice talk on your work on the relationship between entanglement and complexity. So are there any questions? I would like to open the audience to questions.
Hello.
Yeah.
Yes, please go ahead.
Please go ahead.
So if I have two systems which are not entangled, So is there will be any mutual complexity between the two systems?
If you have systems which are not entangled.
Yes. So is there will be mutual complexity between the two systems?
Are you talking about mutual complexity or complexity in general?
Yeah, complexity, yeah. So can I calculate means complexity?
Yeah, you can calculate complexity, I guess. Let me go back to the beginning of my talk. Yeah, if you just look at this schematic, even if you don't have the entanglement, in this case, this is represented by this cross term between x1 and x2, which I'm sure you can see on your screen. You can in general have some complexity, which you can actually concretely calculate by constructing this circuit made of these unitary operators and optimize their number. Obviously, in this case, you don't have any entangling operator in this circuit, like this entangling operator that I have given in red here.
Okay.
For this, you would need to, for actually computing this this complexity, you would have to construct the minimal, the optimal circuit, which is composed of the minimal possible number of simple unitary operators. For that, you have to, I guess, both of the previous speakers alluded to the method. That's one method is Nielsen's optimization, which will give you the minimal set of unitary operators that you need to go from the reference state to the target state.
Okay, are there any more questions?
Hi, I have a question.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Imagine one has a black hole with a very long interior. As time increases, the interior can actually get very long. It gets more and more complex, but the entanglement entropy basically stays constant. So in that case, what's the relation between entanglement and complexity?
Yeah, I don't have a good answer for that. I would have to calculate for that specific system. By the way, as I mentioned during the talk, this slide, if you are talking about this specific slide, this, as I mentioned, is extremely hand waving. It's not meant to be a serious argument, but yeah, for your specific question, I would have to compute, look at the specific system. I don't have enough intuition to give you a sensible answer offhand.
Okay, thank you.
Okay,
if there are no more questions, are there any more questions? Okay, if there are no more questions, we can thanks Pratim. Thanks for this wonderful talk.